Anyone who has lived near Neon, McRoberts or Jenkins, Kentucky knows of Dr. Acker and the tragedy that happened back in 1985. Dr. Roscoe Jacob Acker came to Letcher County as a very young physician and had become a large part of the community. He was born in 1908 in Boston and his medical degree came from the College of Physicians and Surgeons in 1943. He started practicing in the coal fields after the war when the United Mine Workers offered physicians $30,000 a year to practice in the area. This was a good income during those times. Fleming Neon is a very small town in eastern Kentucky with a population of only around 770 people. After settling in, he built his home in Fleming Neon, and purchased what used to be Fleming Hospital for his office. His home was within eyeshot of his office. Dr. Acker was well known. He was a kind-hearted man who cared for patients regardless of their ability to pay. His office was used in the movie Coal Miner's Daughter. This movie was released only 5 years before this tragedy. Dr. Acker lived through the Depression and didn't hold much trust for banks. He kept all his money in a safe inside his home. There were rumors back then that he had a large sum of money, but nobody knew how much. He and his wife, Dorothea, had two beautiful daughters, Tammy D. and Tawny Rose. A year before the tragedy, Dr. Acker's wife had passed away from cancer and Tammy D. had even taken off the rest of that semester to help her father through his grief. She was enrolled as a psychology student at the University of Kentucky, in Lexington. For the fall semester, she came home to gather some clothes and planned to return back the next day. That evening, intruders entered the home while both were there. At around 10 o'clock, two men dressed in dark suits rang the doorbell of the home. Tammy came to the door and asked what the men wanted over the intercom. They advised they were FBI agents and needed to talk to Dr. Acker about an investigation they were working on. Dr. Acker opened the door and the men flashed badges at him and apologized for bothering them at this late hour. The two men told Dr. Acker they were investigating a former business associate of his and asked if they could come in. After entering, they walked to the kitchen and immediately pointed a gun. They told Dr. Acker if he did what they told him, nobody would get hurt. One of the men demanded Dr. Acker to get on the floor. They removed his glasses, gagged him, tied his hands and feet, and put a sheet over his head. They took his daughter, Tammy, to the bedroom where they did the same, tied her hands and feet, gagged her, and put a sheet over her head. They turned their attention back to Dr. Acker, where they asked him the safe combination. Dr. Acker gave them the safe combination and they wrote the numbers down. After several minutes, they came back and said they couldn't get the safe open. They untied him and took him to the bedroom and forced him to open the safe. After opening the safe, they took him back to the kitchen, tied him back up, and put the sheet back over his head. Then they put the cord from a curling iron around his neck and choked him and left him, thinking he was dead. They left the home with the money they had stolen, believing that both Dr. Acker and his daughter were dead. They piled into their vehicle and headed back down to Florida, where their women were waiting. They had gone quite a ways before Bartley realized he had left a briefcase that he had carried with him inside, but they decided not to turn back and continued on their journey. Dr. Acker didn't know how long he was out, but managed to get loose after a few minutes. He began hollering for Tammy and tried to find her. He went in the direction the men took her and found her lying on the floor in the back bedroom. She was still tied with a sheet over her head. He leaned over to take the sheet off of her head and immediately knew she was dead. She had been stabbed several times and a large butcher knife still had her pinned to the floor. The dispatcher at the Fleming Neon police station received the telephone call at 11:30 that night. Dr. Acker told them he had been robbed and about Tammy. The police arrived at his home within 5 minutes. Numerous local and state officials arrived within the hour. Kentucky State Police, Lieutenant Danny Webb was there by midnight, along with KSB detectives Lon Maggard and Frank Fleming. Lieutenant Webb made the unusual decision to telephone the KSB crime laboratory in Frankfurt, some 200 miles away, and asked that a team of experts be sent immediately to Fleming Neon. While the detectives were investigating the scene and gathering evidence, the three men who planned and followed through on a lavish spending spree traveling south. They were headed south to reunite with Sherry Hodge and Carol Epperson in Ormond Beach, Florida. After reuniting with Carol and Sherry, they were all celebrating like a victorious team, hugging, kissing, feeling and touching the money. Sherry took charge of counting the money and being the bookkeeper for the group. Later that night she told them she had an announcement to make, they had reached $1 million. Sherry continued to count and about midnight announced they had reached $1,600,000. At this point they stopped counting. It's estimated that the amount stolen was around $1.9 million. Their spending trails led to their arrest in a rented condominium in Ormond Beach, Florida. Benny Hodge, Roger Dale Epperson, Donald Terry Bartley and their companions, Sherry Hodge and Carol Epperson were captured and charged with capital murder in the death of Tammy Acker. They were also charged with attempted murder, first-degree robbery and first-degree assault. Two of the three men were arrested on August 8, 1985 in Ormond Beach, Florida by the FBI. The third was arrested a short time later in Daytona Beach, Florida. The three are each charged with capital homicide, attempted murder, first-degree burglary and armed robbery. Capital homicide carries a minimum penalty of 20 years and a maximum penalty of death, he said. FBI agents were searching the Ormond Beach apartment, the Corvette and two other cars owned by the three men late Friday, Vatter said. He said the three were believed to have kept several guns, including machine guns, and a large amount of cash in the apartment. Bartley testified against Epperson, saying Epperson orchestrated the whole thing. Bartley was sentenced to 25 years in prison. Hodge received the death sentence. Later Epperson's death sentence was converted to life without parole by Circuit Judge Eddie Coleman. Even though this death sentence was set commuted to life without parole, he is still on death row for the June 1985 murders of Edwin Morris and his wife Bessie. The elderly couple were killed 2 months before Tammy Acker in another home invasion robbery. Dr. Roscoe Acker died later in 2001 at the age of 92. At this time appeals were still taking place but I'm sure he died realizing these men would never see the light of day again and that gave him some peace. The Bible says the love of money is the root of all evil and I believe this tragic death of such a beautiful young woman is evidence of that. May she and her father rest in peace together. A book was written about this tragedy which includes a lot of twists and turns. One such twist was a sketchy lawyer who took stolen money that belonged to Acker for payment to represent one of the men charged in this crime. If you want to know more, the book can be purchased on Amazon. It was written by Darcy O'Brien and the title is Dark and Bloody Ground. If you enjoyed this true crime story, please subscribe, like and share with your friends. Have a wonderful day and please stay safe out there.